All right, thank you for coming. My name is Nari Garibian. I'm one of the academic counselors here on campus. Thanks for choosing the science lecture to be your event for Flex today. There's many other events going on campus, so like Women's History Month. So thank you for choosing this one. So I don't know if Peter really needs an introduction. We all know him, I think, most of us in the room. I'll let him do the introduction. We all know him. But he was my student. I was his student.
I always learn from my students.
I was his student in statistics back when I was still a student here. So it's nice to now present him and speak on this exciting topic. But before you start, I have a surprise. So Laura Friedman's assembly member, she's Laura Friedman. We have a representative from her office, Blake, and he's a really big support with science, so I'm glad he's here. He's going to present something to you.
Hey Peter, so on behalf of Assembly Member Laura Friedman's office, which we appreciate the work you've done here at the Glendale Community College and of course for coming here today, I wanted to give you this certificate of recognition.
Oh, very nice.
That's very nice.
Of course, yours.
Thank you. I wanted to begin, there's kind of a tradition of riddles going very far back, and paradoxes come before riddles, you could say. There's a paradox, and so I wanted to show you a famous one that I think probably most of you are very familiar with.
There it is! The Bridge of Death!
Oh, great.
Look! There's the old man from scene 24.
What is he doing here?
He is the keeper of the Bridge of Death. He asks each traveler three questions. He who answers the three questions, may cross in safety.
But what if you get a question wrong?
Then you are cast into the gorge of eternal peril.
Oh, wacko.
Who's going to answer the questions? Sir Robin.
Yes?
Brave Sir Robin, you go.
Hey, I've got a great idea. Why doesn't Lancelot go?
Yes, let me go, my liege. I will take it single-handed. I shall make a feint to the northeast.
No, hang on. Just answer the five questions. Three questions as best you can. And we shall watch and pray.
I understand, my liege.
Good luck, brave Sir Lancelot. God be with you.
Stop! Who would cross the Bridge of Death must answer me these questions three. The other side, he see.
Ask me the questions, Bridgekeeper. I am not afraid.
What is your name?
My name is Sir Lancelot of Camelot.
What is your quest?
To seek the Holy Grail.
What is your favorite color?
Blue.
Right, off you go.
Oh, thank you. Thank you very much.
That's easy!
Who approacheth the Bridge of Death must answer me these questions three. The other side he see.
Ask me the questions, Bridgekeeper. I'm not afraid.
What is your name?
Sir Robin of Camelot.
What is your quest?
To seek the Holy Grail.
What is the capital of Assyria?
I don't know that.
What is your name?
Sir Galahad of Camelot.
What is your quest?
I seek the Grail.
What is your favorite color?
Blue. No.
Stop. What is your name?
It is Arthur, King of the Britons.
What is your quest?
To seek the Holy Grail.
What is the airspeed velocity of an unladen swallow?
What do you mean? An African or European swallow?
Huh? I don't know that.
Who do you know so much about swallows?
Well, you have to know these things when you're a king, you know.
A office.
Oh, my goodness. This is like a Monty Python bit, in a way. Every 5 minutes.
See, you talk the chairs, you're like...
I need a chair in the dark. It's definitely a Monty Python bit. So, the senator sent me to thank you very much for coming today to show us Monty Python and the Holy Grail, which is my favorite.
Good.
For letting us be tricked by these great chairs in the dark, but also to thank you for your lifetime of teaching students mathematics, which is what my degree is in. So
thank you very much. That's very nice of you. Okay, let me begin here. So that was a kind of takeoff of a famous of these riddles. So this was just our flyer. Oh, let me give some thank yous first. First to Nade for organizing the science lecture series for the last, couple of years, right? And for helping me very much to make sure I got everything done. So a little beatnik applause for Nade. Also thank all of you for coming. I appreciate it very much. Some of you probably had to come, but still, it's good. It's good of you to come. And also, I want to thank a person who doesn't want to be mentioned publicly, but she did all the slides for me, which was hours of work, and that's Irina Shumakova. So a little. let me just go to the first riddle here, the first paradox. I'm going to talk about this riddle here that this picture illustrates. It's Socrates at Buridan's Bridge. Buridan was a philosopher of like the 14th century, and he got interested in this idea of a paradox. So the paradox is, it's like one of these famous things where it's a thought experiment. Socrates is given this riddle. In order for him to cross the bridge, he has to answer this riddle. And the riddle was given by, I have it on a slide somewhere, but I don't know where it is right now, so I'll just tell you, by I guess Plato, who is a student, but Plato says, you have to tell me what I'm going to do, or else I'm going to and it has to be correct, or else I'm going to cast you into the river there. And usually the riddle is given like this. You have to tell me something true, like what I'm going to do, or just something true. But to me, that's silly. He would just say, you are a mortal, and you are a mortal, and then it would be true, and he could pass. But I think the idea is he has to tell him what he's going to do. So what is he going to do? Socrates says to him, you are going to throw me in the river. So Plato says, okay, I'm going to throw you in the river. Wait a minute, if that's true, if I throw you in the river, you told me something true, and I told you I wouldn't throw you in the river if it was true. So wait a minute, maybe it's false. It's false that I'm going to throw you in the river. So I won't throw you in the river. That's confusing also. And that's a special kind of a paradox that is very similar to a lot of paradoxes. You could say, in mathematics, we might say it's isomorphic or homomorphic. I can never remember which is which. But it's equivalent to this famous one, the liar's paradox, which is this statement is false. Or the barber's paradox. I think this, the lore has it that this was in Cambridge. There was a barber that had a sign that said, this barber, I forgot his name, cuts everyone's hair who doesn't cut their own. So who cuts the barber's hair? And you'll see, you'll end up in this same sort of confusing riddle. But anyway, the idea was that Socrates confused Plato and he was able to pass. The funny thing is, philosophers get all interested in this, and one guy proposed, okay, it's confusing, so he lets him pass, which he said he would do if he told the truth, then he throws him into the river afterwards. So I don't know, the whole thing is very silly, you know, that one would do that. But first of all, what is a paradox? We have these three different definitions. One is a paradox is something that is seemingly absurd or self-contradictory, but when you investigate it, it proves to be well-founded. So it's something that seems strange or weird, but after you think about it for a while, or you could be convinced that it makes sense. There's the kind of opposite of something that is clearly false, but that you can use sound reasoning or apparently sound reasoning to prove it. So something's odd about that also. But the best definition I got from my Greek teacher, Professor Zagoudi, who just went back to the Greek, paradoxia, would it be? Paradoxia, which para is against. It also has about 300 other meanings. And doxia is expectation or belief. So it's anything that's sort of against an expectation. So let's take this very broad idea of a paradox. And then let's start looking at some paradoxes. Anyone know who this is? Kierkegaard. Who said that? Very good. And John, you knew that? Wow. I never would have recognized Kierkegaard. Soren Kierkegaard, Danish philosopher. I want to convince you that paradoxes are in some way important. Here's what Kierkegaard says. But one must not think ill of the paradox, for the paradox is the passion of thought. And the thinker without the paradox is like the lover without passion, a mediocre fellow. But the ultimate potentiation of every passion is always to will its own downfall. And so it is also the ultimate passion of the understanding to will the collision. Although in one way or another, the collision must become its downfall. And I just love this last line. This then is the ultimate paradox of thought, to want to discover something that thought itself cannot think. So we want something, and I want to come back to this at the end in this idea of human nature, that thought possibly can't be what helps us overcome this great paradox of human nature, our two warring sides, you could say. Another interesting thing, I didn't know this. Anyone know the word potentiation? I had to look it up. It means when an enhancement of one agent by another agent creating something that's more than either one, the sum of either of the two together, a potentiation. So the ultimate potentiation of every passion, it's enhancing it in a way. Okay, onward. Mother Teresa weighed in on the paradoxes. I have found the paradox that if you love until it hurts, there can be no more hurt, only more love. Now, this is very interesting, and again, I think it will kind of serve my thesis, if you will, and the point I want to make at the end, that there's something about a paradox that's a struggle. It's either the struggle of two ideas or the struggle of two natures, or it's some kind of conflict between things. But this is implying that conflict is good. It's kind of against our normal view of things. We like to think that, no, we try to lessen the stress, keep the conflict down. But even Mother Teresa, all right, I wasn't saying anything, Mother Teresa. No, but she weighs in on it. Okay, so I want to go through the types of paradoxes, give you some examples of paradox, get to the paradox of human nature, and then answer any questions you might have. So this person proposed in 1962 these three types of paradoxes. A veridical paradox produces a result that appears absurd, but it really is true. We'll look at a couple odd ones. falsitical, it's actually false, the horse paradox. All horses are the same color. I'm going to prove that to you. And Zeno's dichotomy paradox, you can never leave this room because you have to go halfway and halfway and halfway and halfway an infinite number of times, and that can't be done. And then an antinomy, a self-contradictory result by applying accepted ways of reasoning. We'll look at this kind of interesting one, but really these antinomies reduce to the liar's paradox very much. This one is kind of interesting. We'll get to it. It was just, I thought I'd throw in some things that you might not know. So the Monty Hall paradox. So this one's animated, right? I think some of you may know about this, but many of you may not. There's a very popular game show that was on in the afternoon, I think in the 60s and maybe even into the 70s, called Let's Make a Deal. And it was hosted by this person, Monty Hall. And it had this very kind of silly thing that he would give the people a choice of three. They were curtains, not doors. You could choose behind one of these three doors. You could choose one and only one. And then he would always do this trick, and he would offer you money to do these different things. But you pick one of the three doors, and behind one of those doors is a grand prize, a new car, a Corvette or something. And behind the other two doors is something much less grand. In this example, it's two goats, but I think there was usually a fondue set behind one of them, which was this bizarre thing, this culinary artifact that everyone was into having fondue, but that's gone away. But think of the two goats behind the other. So you pick one. What are your chances of getting the big prize? There's three doors. What's your chances?
One third,
one out of three, okay? So he would always say, okay, I'm going to open one of the other doors. Now, he knows where the grand prize is. So it could be here, here, or here. But he knows at least one of these two doors is the goat. So he would open the door, and there would be a goat there, and say, okay, I'm going to show you that. Do you gain? He would say, would you want to switch your pick now? Do you gain anything? Now, this is kind of perplexing, and I'll be honest, I got it wrong when a buddy of mine tested me on. I said, no, I mean, you could have picked that one to begin with. It's still got to be the same. Or I told my wife about this. She said, well, aren't you down to one out of two now? That's better than one out of three. The strange thing is that you do gain by switching. And let me just show you why. The reasoning is actually very simple. I have a 1 out of 3 chance that this is the right one. If I switch, I will always be right, except if this was the right one. Correct? Because if I switch, you see, if I switch, I will always be right because he's showing me one other one, and I'll switch to the right one unless I got it right the first time. What was my chance of getting it right the first time? So what is my chance of not getting it right the first time?
Two out of three.
And so if I switch, I have a 2 out of 3 chance. It's a little bit counterintuitive. And I was with a little group that presented on this and some other things at a math conference, and people didn't believe it. So we did it with cards, 3 cards. And you can do an empirical test of 20 trials, and you'll see it comes out about 66%. It comes out about 2/3. So it's interesting. I went to a conference on paradoxes once about 10 years ago in New York City, and a friend of mine was in a play, and I went to see the play, and then I went out with a cast, and I told them what I was doing. And there was a woman there, and she seemed a little glazed about this. And I said, do you understand? She said, yeah, but I want the goat. So... So I think that's what my wife would probably want, the goat. I don't want a Corvette, I want a goat. Here's something interesting. If there was one Corvette and two goats, and you want the goat, do you gain by switching then?
Yes.
You see, in other words, Monty Hall would show you another goat. Do you gain by switching?
No.
No, Charlotte, why not?
Because you go from two-thirds down.
To one-third, you do the opposite. So it's kind of an interesting little thing. Anyway, it's the Monty Hall paradox. Someone in Parade magazine, a woman who had a pen name of Marilyn Vos Savant, she's a savant, tried to kind of show how she was smarter than everyone else. She asked several mathematicians that got it wrong, and she understood it. But really, it's a very simple problem. Okay, all horses are the same color. Now, this, I probably don't have time to explain it fully. You're going to have to buy this idea. It's going to be very hard to understand. An induction proof, let me show you this picture. My colleague, an old friend, Steve Marsden, said, show him dominoes. Oh, no, I don't have dominoes. All right. Okay, I'm going to live with it. I'm not getting upset. So the idea of an induction proof is that it has these two parts. You're trying to prove that something's true for all n. Okay, so I'm going to say that any group of horses of size n, and n's an arbitrary natural number, 1, 2, 3, a counting number, is all, that group has all the same color horses. And I can prove that to you because math induction, you first say it's true when n equals 1. If I have a group of one horse, it's got to be the same color as all the other horses. There's only one horse there, okay? Okay? Yeah. Come on. You got to buy that.
Yeah.
Now, the induction part is that I'm going to assume it's true for any size group. And this is an accepted form of proof. And then show that it follows that it's true for n plus 1. So if I take a group of n plus 1 horses, so let's like make a little list of them here, and it'd be horse 1, horse 2, maybe we order them by their weight or something, horse number n, horse index n, and horse index n plus 1, okay? So this is what I'm trying to show, that they're all the same color. So I take out one of those, and now I have n left. The induction hypothesis is they're all the same color. Any group of size n is all the same color, because all I'm doing is assuming that to show that it follows that n plus 1 is. So they're all the same color, but this might be different. Say these are all gray, and these are all, I don't know, white or something. And that one is white. Well, what we'll do is we'll put this one back in the group and then take out the first horse. And then I still have n left. And by the induction hypothesis, I'm assuming any group of size n, they're all the same color. So this has to be the same as all the others, so they all have to be gray. QED. We put that at the bottom of proofs. Quod erat demonstratum. What was to be demonstrated. It's like there, or in your face, or something, you know. So, that's my proof. Now, I tried to explain this to a close relative, and she said, but you can assume that. You can assume that the group of size has, but you can. That's the part you're just going to have to buy now. There's about 20 mathematics professors in this room. Just corner one of them afterwards and they'll explain it to you. It's perfectly legitimate. Okay, now, there's obviously a flaw in my proof. And would one of the math people say what the flaw is? Where does it break down?
Definitely the change is the breakdown of the set. Once you've separated off the one, you get the n, but you don't get the n of the other one.
Mm-hmm. So n is 1. It breaks from 1 to 2.
Yeah, it breaks from 1 to 2. If there were only two horses in my set, horse 1 and horse 2, and I pulled this one aside, that's there, but then I put it back and pulled this one aside, there's no overlapping. So they can't be identical with anything else. And that's the flaw in it. But I deceived you by showing a list of more than two. See, so you may not think about that. And that's happened sometimes accidentally in proofs. You draw a picture of something. That happened to me all the time. Calculus, I draw a picture of something. And the picture looks like it's symmetric in some way when maybe it isn't. So it's interesting because I don't know if it's that interesting. It's classic. It's a classic. Okay. So I asked my Greek teacher here today so she could tell us where Elia was. Do you know where it is? Where is it?
In Olympia.
Oh, in Olympia. Oh, it's actually in mainland Greece. And yeah, modern Greece, in Olympia. Okay, so Zeno was, I think, is it pre-Socratic? 490, around, yes, pre-Socratic. And he started thinking about some of these paradoxes, and there's a lot of one, like if Achilles and the tortoise are in a race and the tortoise has a head start, can Achilles ever catch the tortoise? Because every time Achilles reaches the place the tortoise was, the tortoise has moved a little bit, only a little bit, but it's still moved away. So it's the same idea. Can anybody leave the room? Don is about 10 feet away. He has to go 5 feet. You know, he has to go 5 plus 2.5 plus 1.25 plus and so on and so on. And this is what Zeno, and he had some very good reasoning for the time. He said, you know, I'm going half, 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 and half. You know, I go a half the distance, then a quarter, then an eighth. I can't do it. It's impossible. Can this infinite sum add up to something? And we call it a series, and it can. And the mathematics of, I'm not sure when formalized, maybe with limits, with Cantor or Euler or something, a show, you probably know
maybe
that.
18th century.
Yeah, 18th century probably. It's formalized. An infinite sum can approach a finite limit. Not always. When it can, it's good. We call it convergent. When it can't, it's divergent. There's interesting things. Mathematicians study the divergent ones to see if there is any kind of arithmetic you can come up with there. And there's strange, strange things. Like you can rearrange the numbers and come up with totally different sums to the same series. But I digress. Okay. The Grelling-Nelson paradox, and again, this is just equivalent to the Liar's paradox. You have these two words, autological and heterological. Autological is self-descriptive, like unhyphenated. Right? That word is not hyphenated, so it describes itself. Pentasyllabic, it has five syllables. That has five syllables. That's called autological. And then a heterological adjective is one which is not self-descriptive, like long. Is that a long word? No, it's a short word. It's shorter than the word short, you know. Or monosyllabic, is that descriptive of itself? No. So the question comes up, is the adjective heterological itself heterological, or is it autological? And you get into the same confusion. You get into the same thing that Socrates had discovered to trip up Plato, or that Arthur had sort of discovered in a way. He asked a question to trip up the gatekeeper or the bridgekeeper. Think about it. If it's heterological, then it doesn't describe itself. But the word heterological means it's not self-descriptive, so it doesn't describe itself, so it must be descriptive. It must be self-descriptive. Or is it autological? Does it describe itself? It describes itself. It's a word that's not self-descriptive. Then it's not autological. You end up in the same mess. So you see, it's a paradox. And when there's a paradox, it asks, why is it happening? Is it a problem with language? Is it a problem with understanding? And some of these are just puzzles that don't have an explanation. But sometimes it means that I need some other kind of understanding. I need something else to come in. And this has happened, in a way, in the history of mathematics and maybe other places too. So I thought today we could have a little a little skit from a book that Galileo wrote, which was called Two New Sciences, where he started to think about this question of the infinite. And Galileo always wrote in a dialogue, and he always used these same characters. He used Simplicio, Simplicio, Simplicio is kind of simple. And then Salviati, Salviati is, he kind of knows things. And then sometimes he used Segretti. Of course, he made a terrible mistake. He put the voice of the Catholic Church as Simplicio, and they threw him in house arrest for about 20 years or something. But anyway, here's a little dialogue that's asking the question, if I have the natural numbers, the counting numbers, and the squares, the positive square, I guess they have to be positive, 1, 4, 9, 16, and so on, they're both infinite. So what's going on here? I give you Simplicio and Salviati.
Salviati, here's a difficulty presents itself, which appears to me insoluble. Since it is clear that we may have one line greater than another, each containing an infinite number of points, we are forced to admit that we may have something greater than infinity. Because the infinity of points in the long line is greater than the infinity of points in the short line. This assigning to an infinite quantity a value greater than infinity is quite beyond my comprehension.
Simplicio. This is one of the difficulties which arise when we attempt, with our finite minds, to discuss the infinite, assigning to it those properties which we give to the finite and limited. But this, I think, is wrong, for we cannot speak of infinite quantities as being the one greater or less than or equal to another. To prove this, I have in mind an argument. I take it for granted that you know which of the numbers are squares and which are not.
Yes, yes, I am quite aware that a squared number is one which results from the multiplication of another number by itself. Thus, 1, 4, 9, etc. are squared numbers which come from multiplying 1, 2, 3, etc. by themselves.
Very well, simpleton. Simplicio. And you also know that just as the products are called squares, so the factors are called roots. On the other hand, those numbers which do not consist of two equal factors are not squares. Therefore, I assert that all numbers, including both squares and non-squares, are more than the squares alone. I shall speak the truth, shall I not?
Okay, most certainly.
Just a little explication here. These are contained in here, right? 1, 4, 9, and so on. So he's saying, this looks like more than this. Anybody would say that. Proceed.
Excellent. Okay. If I should ask further how many squares there are, one might reply truly that there are as many as the corresponding number of roots, since every square has its own root, and every root has its own square, while no square has more than one root, and no root more than one square.
Precisely so.
For example.
Yeah.
But if I inquire how many roots there are, it cannot be denied that there are as many roots as the numbers, because every number is the root of some square. But this being granted, we must say that there are as many squares as there are numbers, because there are just as numerous as the roots, and all the numbers are roots. Yet at the outset, we said that there are many more numbers than squares, since the larger proportion of them are not squares.
Hmm. What then must one conclude under these circumstances?
So far as I see, we can only infer that the totality of all numbers is infinite, that the number of squares is infinite, and that the number of their roots is infinite, and the attributes of equal, greater, and less are not applicable to the infinite, only to finite quantities.
So very wisely, Galileo was thinking about this. He didn't get it quite right, but for the time, he started to realize that you could compare infinity if you could put it in a correspondence with something that you know the size of. This is there's an infinite number of natural numbers, but that we can say that this has the same size because, as was discussed in that dialogue, for every square, there's its square root. And for every number, you can square it. So they're the same size, and we have a symbol for this, aleph null. It's kind of like an N. And aleph null, aleph zero. And what he didn't realize at the time, and it took this other mathematician, I sort of have all these pictures of men that I kind of gave up and didn't get Cantor in there, but this great mathematician, Georg Cantor, he realized that there could be an infinity of different levels of infinity. And it's actually very clever. You could take this and then find all the subsets of it, all the sets that have just one element, all the sets that have two elements, all the sets. And then you have this big collection, and it can't be put into a one-to-one correspondence. And so he realized that there was a kind of ordering. You have aleph null, aleph 1, aleph 2, and so on. There's an infinite number of sizes of infinity, whatever that means, you know. And it's that itself is even called Cantor's paradox. So it's just kind of interesting that Galileo was an early thinker about this. Great quote, isn't it? You cannot teach a man anything. You can only help him find it within himself. Okay, onward. David Hilbert, a great mathematician. He proposed in 1900 something like, I showed again, 23 problems that were unsolvable at the time. And he said, we should solve these in the next 100 years, big problems. And then that was kind of thrown a curveball when Kurt Gödel realized that some things are not going to be solvable. And so that could never be completed. But he was thinking about infinity, and I'll just show you his quote. The infinite exclamation, no other question has ever moved so profoundly the spirit of man. And so he was thinking about this. He's got, and it's called Hilbert's Hotel, this hotel with an infinite number, a countably infinite number of rooms, because you can have uncountable infinities like this one, but countably one, you could put it in a one-to-one correspondence. What if some other people show up? Like if 10 people show up, can you fit them in the hotel? If it's full, if it's already full, it's got an infinite number of rooms and every room is occupied. He said, sure, just move the first person to room 11, the second person to room 12, and then you got these 10 rooms free. So that was kind of interesting. So then he thought, well, what if an infinite number of people show up, like a countably infinite number of people show up? Could you still fit them in your hotel? He said, sure. Move the first one to the second room, the second one to the fourth room, the third one to the sixth room, and then you've left open 1, 3, 5, 7, 9, this infinity of rooms, and then you put in your infinity. Then he went one step further, and I don't know the answer to this, you'll have to look it up yourself, but what if you had a bunch of coaches show up? This is pre-bus days, right? Pre-combustion engine, well, I guess not quite pre, it's around 1900. But if you have an infinite number of coaches, each which has a countably infinite number of guests, what do you do then? And he figured out a clever way using the primes or something to move people to the prime numbers, and then you can get everyone in there. I mean, it's an incredible hotel. All right, now, Georg Cantor is credited with creating set theory, which is the basis of mathematics, but around 1900, some people, Bertrand Russell was one of them, realized that there was some problems. It created some paradoxes, and this is a famous one about normal sets. A normal set is a set that does not contain itself, and an abnormal set is a set that does contain itself. Okay, now that's weird. What does it mean that a set contains itself? Can anyone think of an abnormal set? I couldn't. I had to look it up. But if you had something like a normal set might be in the plane, all the points that represent squares. Okay, that would be a set of points that represent squares. The set of all of those would be a normal set. It has the square that, you know, is around zero of length and width one, and so on. You could have all those squares. If you take its complement, all the sets that, all the points that are not that, or I guess all the sets that from each of those, you end up with a set that contains itself because it's not a square and it's a set of points in the plane. So these things exist, but they're abnormal. They're hard to find. But you get into this problem, and it reduces to the Liar's paradox again in a funny way. Is the set of all sets, is the set of all normal sets, normal or abnormal? I did once correct this. I don't know what happened here. This is funny. So there's a set of all normal sets, normal or abnormal, and you get into the same problem. It's the set of all normal sets. So it's got to be in the set of all normal sets. But then it's abnormal, because if it contains itself, it's abnormal. So you get into the same confusion. Now, what this led to was a lot of suffering in the mathematics world, because this wasn't good. It was a problem, and different solutions were proposed. Russell proposed one thing, and these two mathematicians, Zermelo and Frankel, proposed a different sort of improved set of axioms, and they threw in this thing called the axiom of choice, which, frankly, I don't fully understand, because to me it seems so transparently humdrum that I can't understand it, but it's like one of the most important axioms of set theory. It's like if you have a collection of sets, each non-empty, you can create another set by choosing one from each. You know, so what? But that is highly, highly important, and we now call that set theory, of which mathematics now is based on, the ZFC, Z for Zermelo, F for Frankel, and C for the axiom of choice. Anyway, was that free of contradictions? No. These two mathematicians, Banach and Tarski, came up with a proof that they could, using this new set of axioms, that they could take a solid ball in three dimensions, and it could be in multi-dimensions, which is not hard for mathematicians to deal with, but it doesn't work for two dimensions or one. And they could decompose it in a clever way, take it all apart, put it back together, and it forms two solid balls of exactly the same size. What? You know, that's a paradox. In fact, it's sometimes called the P-Sun paradox, because you can decompose a pea, put it back together, and it forms a sun. It forms the mass of a sun, a solid sun. You know, it's like, what? But that's a paradox. And I don't think any suitable explanation has really ever come up, except that the axioms are a little bit paradoxical. They cause these paradoxes. There's tons and tons, by the way, of paradoxes in all walks of science and in economics and decision theory. I think Professor Mike Allen, did a talk about decision theory one time, and, you know, she warned me. She said, make sure you fill this in before you get to the talk. Okay, all right. Let me see if I can remember it, basically. This is in quantum mechanics, and a lot of you know that quantum mechanics has paradoxical things in it. So what was happening was that they have this very strange idea, and again, I do not understand it, I've just read a little bit about it, that a subatomic particle can exist simultaneously in two states. It can decay or not decay. It's not like it's one or the other, I'm just not sure. It actually exists in both at the same time. And this was called the Copenhagen interpretation of quantum mechanics. And Schrodinger didn't like it because everyone said, well, it doesn't matter, it's on the subatomic level, don't worry about reality too much, we're not down there. But he thought of this very clever thing of going from this micro world to the macro world, and he put a cat in a box here, and he put this little device that emits a subatomic particle one per hour. Maybe it might decay, and if it decays, it causes something to fall, it breaks a toxin, and it kills the cat. So what do quantum mechanics people say in Copenhagen? They say the cat is both dead and alive. And so suddenly Schrodinger said, see, your thinking causes problems in the real world. Get your thinking straight. And even though Einstein, who supported in a famous paper parts of these ideas, he told Schrodinger, he said, you're one of the few people who are worried about this important question. What does it mean in reality? What happens is that, I think you all know this, this is the uncertainty principle, but that as soon as it's observed, the cat is either dead or alive. You look in the box, it collapses. The superposition of these two states collapses to a single state. And but this is a very perplexing idea. But anyway, in quantum mechanics and higher physics, these things occur. That is funny.
Do you want to take some questions? We have 5 minutes.
Oh, we only have about 5 minutes. Okay, yes, we should. Let me see what else I had here. Simpsons, hedgehog. Let me just quickly mention the hedgehog dilemma. This came from Schopenhauer, and it's basically that the hedgehogs or porcupines, they want warmth. They're out in the cold, and they try to get together, but when they get together, they prick each other, and so they go apart. And they get together, they go apart, and finally they just give up. And what Schopenhauer said, this is human interaction. That we can't get together because we're too prickly. That we cause all this prickliness. And let me see. The willpower paradox, just very quickly, very interesting, that if you say, I will do this, you have a worse chance of doing it than if you say, will I do this? It's kind of like the way it says here, an open mind. But if you're questioning, there's psychological experiments divided into two groups, you know, the whole thing. And the one group keeps repeating, I'm going to do it, I'm going to do it. And the other group says, will I do this? What's going on here? They have a much better way, a much better chance of doing it. And it's, you know, it's a real research here at the University of... Prisoner's Dilemma is great, but we don't have time. Oh, there we have Socrates at Verdun. I wanted to... First of all, it's Women's History Month, and I didn't have too many women here, so I wanted to add photographs of two very important women of the 20th century. One was Mother Teresa, and this is Jeanne de Saltzman. And she wrote a lot about this idea that we have two natures. And let me just read it. I have to know that I have a double nature, that there are two forces in me, the descending force of manifestation, my behavior. I'm manifesting all of my function, all of it, including probably almost all of my emotions, and an ascending force returning to the source. I have to experience them here at the same time to know myself as a whole. There must be a reason why I am here, something that is needed for a relation between the two. This is the meaning of my presence. And I thought this connected very well with what some of these other people were finding, that in we have this innate paradox in us. That's strange, because usually evolution takes care of things that aren't working too well, these two different natures at war with each other. You would think that the non-warring, the Neanderthal, or the person that didn't have this would be selected. But it makes me wonder, is there something that is actually needed? Not my idea, by the way. I like this brilliant new idea that I've come up with. This is an interesting idea that it's actually very important, because these two different natures create a kind of tension in us, and that causes an intensity that's needed in life. I mean, on a simple level, it's a runner, and he's tired, the body wants to stop, and he perseveres. And sometimes you all know the story, or you've experienced it, of having the second wind. And I wonder if it's true on a deeper level that our nature requires us to feel these two different forces, my desire, and sometimes it said my desire and non-desire. Anyway, I didn't leave enough time, but I packed in too much material. If you'd like to ask any questions right now, I'd like to.
What is the ascending force? You said the other one was the manifestation of your behavior.
Okay, so what is the ascending force? This is a very good question, because what Charlotte is saying, which is very good, I don't have two natures. I have my manifestations. But the way it's sometimes put is the ascending force is my wish to be, my wish to have meaning. You see, all of my impulses, in a way, take me away from that. It's what Abraham Lincoln might have called the higher angels of our spirit, or whatever. Is that what it is? Higher. Any other questions? Good question. I'm glad you asked that. No other questions. Well, thank you all. Thank you very much. Thank you, guys.